Get ready for the trip of a lifetime. This is the series that brings you the most incredible and downright shocking holiday behaviour. Capturing stupid antics on smartphones. With a camera in every tourist pocket, we're getting into the action like never before. Raw, real, and uncensored. This is the world's wildest holidays. Coming up, we go all wobbly on the piste. There's a dust-up at a bus stop and an incredible journey on a tiny motorbike. Unless you decide to stay in your back garden, holidays inevitably involve travel. And if there's one thing we can be certain of, it's that all forms of transport can be very, very dangerous. This lad was backpacking around the world and was just about to record a video message for back home. Holy freight trains, that was close! Let's have another look. Millimeters from death, but what actually hit him? It's a kick in the head! Mr. Driver, you're meant to stamp his ticket, not his face. Presumably he'll be in shock after that.
Wow, that guy kicked me in the head! I think I got that on film!
Yes, you did catch it on film. On the plus side, it might have knocked some sense into you. Surely the least dangerous form of transport has to be the bus. Nah, not this one. This bus is on the notorious Basisahar Shame Road in Nepal. And yes, that is a 2,000-foot drop with no guardrail.
Oh,
oh
my God!
OMGs all round. I bet they're glad they're inside a nice, safe bus.
Consider these doors might not be that secure.
In that case, don't lean on them! This must be the most dangerous bus trip in the world. Apart from the night bus in Glasgow, of course. Hold on, where's he going?
So we've now got to a stage where the roof rack's going to get stuck under the overhang, so Rinku's had to go ahead and scope out the height so we can get through with a van. It's the narrowest piece of road we've been down.
Presumably, this could mean going even nearer the edge. Oh, I thought it might.
Absolutely the maddest road I've ever been down.
Blimey, thank goodness that's over. Surely it can't get any worse than that.
Look at that! Oh my word.
Ah, yes. Of course, a huge waterfall.
Absolutely amazing. Ready? It's going to look good. It's going to destroy the camera.
If I remember my maths correctly, rock plus water times slippy road carried to 4 equals... Get me off this bus!
Well, here we go. Oh no! Stop it! I can't close the window!
All right, a wet seat. That's the least of your worries, pal.
No, we can sit there now.
After that trip, I think all the seats are going to be wet. How about another bus that likes going off-road? Yep, here's the bus. Looks pretty standard. Until it does this. No, the driver hasn't made a terrible error. This is the amphibibus that crosses the Terengganu River in Malaysia. What a very good idea. If you ever do go on it, try to get a seat on the top deck, unless you're very good at holding your breath. But by far the most common travel fear isn't trains or buses, it's planes, and for a good reason. Here's a plane trying to land at the airport on the popular holiday island of Madeira. As you'll notice, it's quite hilly. In fact, the runway is uphill.
Bing bong! This is your captain speaking. Today, just to mix things up a bit, we've decided to land sideways.
It must be a work experience pilot. That explains it. Let's have another go, eh? Because 10 minutes later, the fog's rolled in. And he's going for another sideways landing. This must be a queasy jet flight. It's a good job the plane's a long way away, because the sound of passengers screaming can give you a headache. Try number 3. Come on, fella. You need to do this to get your pass in GCSE piloting. How does he make it hover like that? That is not normal. And third time lucky. Thank heavens.
Bing bong. Doors to manual. Cross-check and please wait until you're in the arrivals area before throwing up or releasing your bowels.
But after all those terrifying transport tales, here's a guy who's made a career out of circumnavigating the world. And if he's done that, he must be really smart. Okay, maybe not smart exactly. Let's meet the guy and hope for the best.
Ow. My name is Ed March. I'm from Devon. I'm an adventure motorcyclist, and the most unique thing about the way that I travel is that I do it on a pizza delivery bike.
Somebody, somewhere, is going to be waiting quite a while for their margarita. Anyway, back to the story.
I had a small, slow bike, which is nice and cheap, and I thought, everybody around the world rides one of these, so I'm going to post it to the furthest landmass from England, fly there, and try and ride it home.
If you post a motorbike, good luck getting it in a jiffy bag. So where did you go?
This is me on my first ever trip. That's going through Thailand. And just every single day, there was something that you just did not expect to see, like, you know, bikes carrying 500 ducks on the back. Petrol stations that don't have pumps, they just keep all of the petrol in and Coke bottles and they get out of the funnel. That's me going over the Himalayas, and I kept finding hitchhikers and taking them over top, which the only way to make a bike with 6 horsepower go slower is to put a hitchhiker on the back. That was Christmas Day in Thailand. 4 foot high Christmas tree on the back.
Very festive. But anyone could do that. Show us something more unusual.
This was the footage that terrified my mum, where I bribed the Cambodian army with £200. I was riding around one-handed, firing belt-fed machine guns and throwing live hand grenades.
I'm holding a live hand grenade.
When you're holding a hand grenade with the pin pulled out, it's pretty terrifying. But fun. Oh.
Messing about with guns and bombs is really very daft, Ed. Even if the Cambodian army say it's okay. I'm afraid I'm going to have to call your mum. But did you have any experiences that were properly scary?
Yeah, this was... That was as I was in India.
That lorry is going rather fast. That's the wrong side of the road. That is ever so close. I hope nothing terrible happens. Whoa, Nelly!
There is complete silence from me for about 5 seconds.
Yep, complete silence from Ed, broken only by the lorry driver's cries for help.
I can't even compute what's going on. There's this thing in your brain where you're like, is this going to blow up? What do I do?
I'll tell you what you do. Get the hell out of there. Just going to go up. And while you're doing that, give us some facts and figures about your trip.
I've done about 120,000 miles over 5 years in total. I thought, I reckon overall I'll be happier if I actually fill my head with memories rather than a thing that's made of bricks. You know, and that was it, really. I just wanted to see the world, and I thought I would rather die poor and have loads of memories rather than be rich and have just stayed at the same job for the whole of my life, really.
Let's hope Ed's memories go up in value so he can have a happy retirement. Incidentally, if anyone wants to buy a Honda C90 motorbike, 120,000 miles, one careful owner, are you totally crazy? Some more holiday mayhem in a mo, but first, take a look at this. Some guys were on holiday in the Australian outback when they spotted something you don't see every day. But can you guess what happens next? The dogs free, run away, or face him out. Hold on, did he really do what I thought he did? Now bear in mind, a kangaroo kick can easily disembowel a human. Come on, put him up, put him up! Have that! It's hard to tell from the look in the kangaroo's face whether he's stunned or worried what the other kangaroos are going to say. Well, When people go on snowy holidays, they often think they're being pretty cool. They get to wear groovy shades, hang about on the slopes, and film themselves doing it. And when the slippy snow makes people fall flat on their faces, it's always worth watching. Right, let's kick off with an easy one. Before you even get on the snow, you've got to get off the lift. Shouldn't be too tricky, should it? Ah, yes, perhaps it is. That's enough of people falling over on skiing holidays. Only joking. We've got plenty more of the good stuff. Take this guy, for instance. His state of wobbliness would indicate that après-ski has been enjoyed. All he needs to do is get his feet in the skis. Yeah, no. He'll be fine. Perhaps the après-ski will act as antifreeze. Right, let's have a look at this lad. All right, a young snowboarder. He's got all the gear. Looks like he knows what he's doing. No, he doesn't. Never mind, it's only a minor setback. Just pick yourself up. Dust yourself down. Get in position. And fall down all over again. He clearly doesn't have a clue what he's doing. How about wobbly guy? Aye, aye, he's still at it. Bit of a struggle. Oh, look, a horse. But at least he's got a mate to help him. Ah, a friend in need. Is a chance to shove someone onto their face. What a shambles. Hold on, this gives me an idea. It's a battle royale. Wobbly guy versus newbie. Who will get on their feet first? Game on. Right. Here's newbie for his third attempt. He's getting some tips from the attendant. And as expected. And there's some seconds for you. I hope you haven't got anywhere to go, because this might take a while. Wobbly guy has finally got his skis on. Can he take the prize here? I've got a tip for you. Pick your friends more carefully. It's newbie again. Has he learned anything? Oh, a disaster. But at least he's got a couple of metres up the slope. So that's an improvement, I suppose. Hurry up, mate. Your lift pass only lasts a week. Right, wobbly guy and his mate are working together. Bosh! And boom! Man down. Again. Come on, newbie. The crown's there for the taking. All you need to do is get up the slope. It's an unorthodox tactic, but it's working so far, until it doesn't. Hopeless! Come on, man, it's not water skiing. Eh, whatever floats your boat. Hold on, hold on. This is looking tasty. Could it be just a little bit further? I'm really sorry about this. I didn't expect it to take this long. But seeing as we're in it for the long haul, let's give Wobbly Guy one more chance. Oh, because he is up and on his feet. And on his backside. Come on, newbie. Can you just manage to stay on your feet for once, please? Right, hold on to your hats and your ski lift thing, whatever they're called. He's off. He's hanging. This could be it. Just a few more meters. Yes! Yes! He's done it! Newbie has beaten Wobbly Guy in the battle to stay upright. It was a truly epic contest, but in the end, there could only be one winner. Gravity. Keep your eye on the man on the sledge hurtling towards the camera. I guess after skidding down a mountain on your bum, it's time to hit the bar. Oh! If he's like this when he gets to the bar, what's he going to be like when he leaves? George! Now we travel to Eastern Europe, where a mountain rescue professional who was snowed under at work escaped to the slopes for a quick holiday and found himself under some snow, which is ironic, if you think about it.
So my name is Sorin Alexandru Radu. I'm 28 years old. I'm from Romania. I'm currently a volunteer at a mountain rescue team, and I went there to train for 1 week, but it was a foggy weather for the, I don't know, last 3 days. And when I've seen sunshine, my first thought was to go on top of the mountain and try to go for a run.
For a mountain rescuer, it's a bit of a busman's holiday, if you ask me. Still, must have been nice to be back out in the slopes after all that fog.
Because of the different weather conditions, it just creates different layers, just like on a cake. So you have sunny weather, afterwards it snows and it gets colder, afterwards it's sunny again.
That sounds dangerous, but off you go. So what happened next? All right, a flipping avalanche happened next. This is what an avalanche looks like from the inside.
I was trying somehow to swim in the snow and stay on top of it. If the avalanche, it would go on for another 4 to 5 seconds, I think I wouldn't have this interview with you anymore.
Come on, you're being a bit overdramatic. You can always count on your brave and hardworking mountain rescue colleagues to save you.
I had to take out myself from the snow. I radioed the guys from the rescue team. And I went through the radio and, guys, can you bring me a shovel? And they meant, dude, the slopes are quite busy, we can't go.
What? So these mountain rescue guys are too busy to rescue you, a mountain rescuer off a mountain? This world, eh?
And after 1 minute, I've tried to take my right foot out of the snowboard. It took something like 5 minutes, it was easy. But the left one, it took me around 35 minutes to get it out because the snow just pushed me in front and I was just leaning in front of the snowboard.
Doesn't sound too bad when you tell it like that.
Man, it was a huge avalanche.
Okay, fair enough. But Soren, having dug yourself out of a snowy grave, have you got any advice for holidaymakers who get trapped in a similarly snowy situation?
When you're going on with all these extreme sports, you kind of take your own risk. So the best way to be safe in an avalanche is not to get involved in one.
And if you do get caught in an avalanche, don't call Mountain Rescue because they'll be too busy. From the treacherous snowy slopes to the haven of the sandy beach, where it ought to be about kicking back and relaxing in the shade. These two senior gentlemen are in a dispute about who got to the beach umbrella first. They're throwing shade about being in the shade.
You've got everything else.
First rule of diplomacy, always keep a channel of negotiation open. That's it, mate. Stand on the table, and you're more or less the same height. That is a proper WWE wrestling move. If he doesn't call it the beer cooler, he really should. If this was in pay-per-view, they'd raise at least enough for an ice lolly. Maybe they're doing it to show off in front of their partners. She does seem keen on the bloke in the hat. All that testosterone. You're a tiger. Some British tourists were waiting to catch a bus in Ibiza when they filmed an altercation between a bus driver and two passengers. Bus driver's clearly not afraid to take on a younger man, but he hadn't reckoned with the tactics of his girlfriend. That's what's known in the trade and playgrounds throughout the land as an atomic wedgie.
Really not sure what's going on.
I don't know what's going through the driver's mind. It got out of his pants by the looks of things. What's going on is a two-on-one bundle. This is shocking behaviour. Eventually, the bystanders saw sense and came in to break it up and pulled the younger man away from the driver. All that did was leave an opening for the girl to take over. Eventually, the bystanders just gave up trying to stop it and let them get on with it for a bit. Pull up a chair. Surely they'd lose interest once his pants were up again.
Pause.
Nope. Round two. Eventually the fight ended, but the poor driver had to go to hospital to have his underpants surgically removed from his bottom. Typical. You wait ages for a bus-related punch-up, and then two come along at once. A traveller in the Philippines caught this Barney between a driver and a conductor on camera. Look out, there's a bus stop coming. Bus stop, bus stop. Ah, never mind. I'm not convinced by their technique. I think they need a bit of coaching. But after a few moments, the passengers do the sensible thing and leg it off the bus. What are they fighting about? Oh, maybe it's who's in charge of the remote control for the movie on the onboard TV. The driver wants Fast and Furious 8, The Fate of the Furious, and the conductor wants Frozen. It's a common problem. Eventually, they agree to disagree. The conductor got off, and the passengers got back on. If any of them haven't paid for their ticket yet, it's their lucky day! It goes to show that picking a holiday punch-up is never a great idea. And it's an even worse one to pick a fight with a bouncer. A bouncer's for a reason. This doorman has his eye on two lads who've just been chucked out of a bar in Ireland. Can't imagine why. And they appear a little unhappy about it. Now they're taking it up with a gentleman on the door. Dear, oh dear, there was absolutely no need for that. Possibly seen a few too many Jackie Chan movies. Here it comes. Oof! And again.
Game over.
I have to say, I think they had it coming.
He's gone.
Come on, guys. Leave it. This doorman knows his stuff. You wouldn't let it lie, would you? And now you're lying. On the ground. In the end, they wobbled off with their tails between their legs. You're not coming in here. In fact, the only place you're going is hospital. In a few moments, we'll be hitting the beach. But before then, we're in the car park near the beach. Not much to see right now. Bit of reversing going on. But something spectacular is about to be caught on camera. Can you guess what happens next? Well, it's not a low-speed denting incident or a parking fine being issued. It's a bit more dramatic than that. There she blows! That is going to be a very interesting insurance claim.
Wow!
Assuming your car hasn't been crushed by a landslide, there are only three essentials you need for a day at the beach. Sun cream, ice cream, and most important of all, a camera phone. And that's so you're always ready to capture the action when beaches bite back. Don't believe me? Check this out. This baby is getting its first taste of laid-back beach life. There you go, little un. Breathe it all in.
Thanks,
Dad. Yeah, thanks, Dad. I'm not sure what's more worrying, the fact it's been dressed in a curtain or that it's been traumatised by a wave. When there's a storm raging near the coast, don't stand on the beach. Make sure to be at a safe distance away on the promenade. Where are they off to? Second thoughts, make sure you're at a safe distance by staying indoors. As we've seen, beaches are not to be trusted, so this couple have been all different and decided to hold their wedding not on a beach, but on a small pier. Yes, very groovy. Attractive friends, attractive couple, able to afford all the travel to some exotic location for the ceremony. Everything is absolutely perfect. Lucky them. Mind you, that is quite a lot of people in that rickety old wood pier. You might want to... Think about holding the ceremony underwater. Yep, that's pretty much the entire wedding party in the sea. Perhaps they planned a collapsing pier, so you'd all have some really cool anecdotes about our wedding later, yeah? Okay, if you've enjoyed those soggy clips, we've got one more for you. Meet newlyweds, Marilys and Ryan Dreyer, who nearly waved goodbye to their lives as they travelled the world on their honeymoon.
We decided for a honeymoon, rather than just a week or two away at a nice expensive hotel, we'd actually go travelling. The plan was we'd go to Southeast Asia, went to South Africa for Christmas to visit the family.
Everything was going swimmingly until Marilise decided to get creative with a camera on a South African beach, a decision that led to honeymoon horror.
I had an idea of a photo that I wanted. I had spotted this amazing rock and the waves had been crashing over it lovely, and we'd been checking out for quite some time.
Right, Marilise. So you're perched on a rock near a raging sea. You've got your photo op. I can't imagine what'll happen next. Cue a big wave? Nah, that's a bit small. Can you do any better? That's more like it.
Yeah, that's very scary. My heart's actually racing a bit looking at it, actually.
And the big wave hadn't just ruined their photo. It had something special in store for Marilise too.
Because it was so slippery and green mossiness around us, I was trying to hold on for dear life. And I had put my foot into a crevice to try and basically keep myself on the rocks. And then when the bigger wave came, the force of the wave just threw me out of the crevice of the rock. And as soon as I came back out bobbing on the other side, my ankle was flopping around everywhere.
Flopping hell!
The doctor, after having x-rayed it 3 times, explained to me that I had a bimalleolar fracture and dislocation, which was very big words for telling me that both of the bottom ends of my ankle had broken off.
That sounds horrific. Once they'd opened up her ankle, inserted metal plates and pins and sewed her back up again, she was half woman, half IKEA bookcase. But since this wave nearly took you to your grave, have you got any of that famous near-death experience wisdom to lay on us?
Yeah, I mean, if I had to give some advice on what we learned from the incident, I would always say, yeah, go for it. I mean, if you want the photo, do it.
I'm not sure your wife agrees. Hashtag awkward. Surely there's nothing safer than a holiday at the biggest theme park in the world. In Disney World here, everything's laid out for you. You don't even need to leave the park. The entertainment comes to you. Great! It's the Disney Parade! And there's the fairy godmothers from Sleeping Beauty. Now that is a classic film. None of your CGI nonsense. Hold on. What's that? The dragon is on fire! I mean, really, on fire! Repeat, the dragon is on fire! I'm no expert, but if there was a 30-foot animatronic mythical lizard with a built-in flamethrower on fire near me, I'd probably move a lot further back. Like the next state. Tell you what, you've got to respect this dragon. Even when its head is an inferno, he's still following the script. What a trooper! Yes, when fire strikes on holiday, it can be a truly terrifying thing. As we've seen, sometimes holidays can be a little bit too hot, as was the case in May 2018, when a hotel fire in Magaluf made headlines across the world. The papers claimed that the fire was started by some lads setting each other's feet alight. Can't be right, can it? To find out the real story, we got in touch with John Wilkes. An actual eyewitness.
Rufus, in your bed.
To this hotel horror story.
So, me and my dad went on a stag do to Magaluf. It was absolutely epic. Magaluf is a place of dreams. It's just like, you go there, you get pissed, you pull girls or boys, whatever you're into. You know, it's just express yourself. It's full of, like, things that you wouldn't do normally when you're at home. Girls out of Magaluf, they're fruity, they're fun, they express themselves. That's the best way to put it.
Okay, John, I'm glad you and your dad had fun with the fruity senoritas. But we got you here to tell us about the distressing incident that took place right in front of your eyes.
This is my dad's video that he recorded. It is crazy. You can see the fire. If you look on the balcony, like, there's only a tiny bit of flame. And then if you give it like 5 or 6 seconds, there you go. Now it's just exploded. It's gone massive. And then people are running in and out. It gets more intense, it gets more real, it gets more scary.
As we said, the cause of the fire, according to the papers, was banter gone bad. Some guys setting each other's feet on fire. But as our on-the-scene accident investigator, John, what actually went down?
We still don't know what's happened.
OK, that's disappointing. But you must have some theories.
the actual story, who was involved. You only get second names. You're never going to know. And to be fair, still now, I'm still wondering what actually happened, because I'd love to know why. If they were having a barbecue, why are you having a barbecue at an all-inclusive hotel?
Now, that's a very good point. I hadn't thought of that.
If they were having a fag, why were you smoking in the no-smoking room, so you're daft? Or why were you setting your mate's feet on fire? Really? Unless they're proper hairy and you're burning the hairs off, why would you do that? It's stupid. So I'm still wondering, well, until this point, what happened? You know, why?
I'm definitely going with your unusually hairy feet theory, John. Thank you. Okay, that was pretty wild. Hotel room on fire. But now we're going to up the ante with a holiday fire that was 120 kilometres long. Or to put it more vividly...
Fucking hell, look at this.
Meet Peter and Vera, whose family holiday to Australia took a turn for the worse after a foolish attempt at taking the scenic route through the bush.
So we went on holiday to Australia to do a road trip from Darwin to Adelaide. We have family in Australia. When we were staying with our family in Whyalla, they decided to recommend a different route to go to Adelaide.
Who wants to get somewhere quickly on a nice, safe motorway?
The normal route is just kind of motorway on the coast, and they said, now if you take sort of parallel, more inland road, it's more interesting. You get to the hills, you have nice views, and so we did.
What they didn't realise is that one of these nice views would turn out to be something a lot more lethal. I'm starting to be a bit suspicious about Peter's Australian family.
Quite soon after committing to that road, we saw this big cloud appearing in the sky on the horizon. We thought it was a cloud, and it stayed there. It just looked like a big weather front. We just really enjoyed it.
Excited by weather. OK. Well, unfortunately for the weather front fans, this exciting weather event turned out to be a raging inferno.
We didn't have a sense of panic at that point.
No, not at all.
There was no sense of urgency, there was no sense of fear, there was no sense of danger. That changed quite quickly when a guy in a white pickup truck came down the opposite side of the highway.
Yeah.
Turn around, mate, get this way.
There's flames.
Yes.
Thank you.
Hot on the heels of the truck driver's advice, Vera received a text that told her to turn on the radio. What she heard chilled them both, which could have been useful given the approaching flames.
Emergency warning for a bushfire burning under catastrophic conditions. There is a risk to lives and property. People in these areas are in danger.
It gave you a warning. It said, if you are in this area, which is exactly where we were, it said, do not drive. It's too late. Latent heat will kill you before the flames get to you.
Peter was starting to panic.
Fucking hell, are we going to get out of this?
Stop it. Slow down.
Oh, no. Don't, Perry, we're in serious trouble here. Fucking hell, Perry, we're in the middle of a bushfire. The fire had actually come round the back of us, and we were sort of almost in a polo mint effect now.
A polo mint? Now is not the time to compare a life-threatening bushfire to sweets.
And the fire had gone behind us, so we're going back down the only road that we had, the only exit we had.
Christ.
The only thing we can see is two lights in front of us. We're travelling at about 60 miles an hour in blackness, focused on two lights, knowing that if he makes a mistake or if he goes off the road, we are going off the road with him. We would have followed him over a cliff if he'd driven over a cliff. That's the panic at that point.
What you are looking at isn't nighttime. The sun was still up, but the smoke was so thick visibility was down to a few meters. And things were about to get worse for Peter and Vera.
The smoke started coming through the vents, and the temperature, which you don't get on the fill, rose enormously. We were in trouble. It was absolute life and death at that moment in time. We were right on the verge. One mistake, left instead of right, brake instead of accelerate, or worse still, the car breaking down, which was the next issue we had. The air intake had gone. The car was running on pure gas rather than fuel and air. I could feel the car slowing. I could feel the car coughing. If we'd stopped, it was game over. We were just barely ahead of the curve on this, but it was catching us.
Death by fire wasn't the only thing on his mind. Peter was already thinking about what would happen afterwards.
I was thinking very rationally. I was aware that there's no way I'm going to stop this film now because I'm actually thinking that this is going to be our evidence, this is going to be our story when the phone is recovered.
Would the old adage, the night is darkest before the dawn, hold true?
We kept going and we came out of the smoke. Coming out of that, it was like a new dawn. I mean, and it was as sudden as going into it. We just whoosh and we're out in sunshine. It was a massively lucky escape for us. It's the closest thing in my life to dying. The things in life that you see, like the tsunami that happened, where you see the footage and you think, it doesn't look too bad. How can that possibly kill people? When you're looking at the water, it's 2 foot deep and it's going through this, how on earth? And when you look at bushfires, you have a similar attitude. You see these things and, you know, they're burning away and you look at them and you think, they look quite inert. But the power of them, the sheer force of nature and the sheer force, if you're in them, unbelievable.
That's very poetic, Peter. It seems this near-death experience has given you a more philosophical outlook on life.
How the f*** are you gonna get out of this?
Or maybe not. Before we leave the world of Holidays on Fire, have a look at this. This speedboat has crashed into the bank of a lake. It's in flames, it's got a tank full of petrol, and it could go up at any moment. Question is, what happens next? Considering it's in flames and has a full tank of petrol, the most likely outcome is explosion.
What are you doing?
Yeah, what is he doing? Oh, yeah. Use a boat to save a boat. That is a great idea. Well done, speedboat driver. Good job, everybody. Oh, yeah, aye. Better safe than sorry, eh? Great. That's definitely got it. Well played. Smashed it out of the park. Boom! The flames are out, but there is a danger of it sinking now. What? What again? No, there's really no need. It's just showing off now. Yeah, right. We've all seen what you can do with your big speedboat. Everyone thinks you're a hero. Got it. Come on, there'll be no water left in the lake at this rate. Or for crying out loud. Let's leave him to it. So far this series, we've seen plenty of wild moments on the water. From Holidays All at Sea to burning ferries. Perhaps it's not the deep blue brine that we should be worried about. It's what's in it that the unsuspecting holidaymaker needs to watch out for. Ah, these playful dolphins are frolicking in the pool. Isn't it wonderful? But in fact, they're plotting against humanity. Don't believe me? Look at its face, gloating. It knows exactly what it's doing. What's that, Flipper? You want to play Fortnite? He'll be straight down the pub with that to offload it to his mate Squirty. 100 squid, easy money. He can pay off that loan shark now. Dolphins can't walk, yet, but something in the water has attracted a lot of attention on this Baltic beach. Is it a shark? A seal maybe? OMG, it's a sea pig! Best thing to do with an aggravated amphibious pig, or amphibipig, is leave it alone, on account of it being 10 stone of muscle with tusks at one end. Oof. Ooh. Ah, they're acting as a team to try to distract it. and one brave soul decides to go head-to-head with a beastly boar and wrestle it. But he swiftly comes to his senses. Eventually, the boar made its escape along the beach. Thank goodness. Exactly what a pig was doing in the sea in the first place is anyone's guess. Once they team up with the dolphins, we are screwed. Meet Charlie Head, whose epic paddleboarding holiday became a mission of mercy when he spotted something out of the ordinary on a groin.
I was just coming to the end of a very long journey, stand-up paddleboarding along the entire south coast of the UK. Just gone around the corner from Ramsgate and coming up the Thames and feeling exhausted. You know, I've been going for a few weeks solidly. And I was just coming along the coast there, and there was just long groin, and I could just see a really awkward mound of fluff sort of fumbling around.
If you weren't aware, a groin is the thing that sticks out into the sea from the beach, and this one had a distressed ball of fluff on it.
Whatever was on the end of this rock just wasn't designed to be there, do you know what I mean?
That's a bit rich, coming from a man on a plank on the sea.
I got closer and closer and closer. It's a ridiculous thing. It's a shih tzu.
It's a not that bad. And don't call me Sue.
I mean, this thing looks like it's never left a handbag. So I paddled up to it, managed to call it onto the board. But to be honest, it was, you know, I can't really swear, but it was shitting itself. So I put it on the board, and then it just leapt off again.
No.
So I was like, okay. Scooped it up, chucked it on, chucked it between my legs, and started to make very pathetic noises.
Just relax. It's okay.
I was always a bit surprised by that when I look back at the video. I've never made noises like that before. I think it's because it was such a small, vulnerable dog that I
made that really cute voice say, come on, Shih Tzu, come onto my board. What are you doing out here? All right, let's get you in.
Whether it was a cute voice or a weird voice didn't matter, because it got the dog on board with the idea of being on board the board.
I managed to kind of calm it down a bit, stuck it between my legs, and glided back into shore.
So let me get this straight. You rescued a soggy doggy from a groin and nestled him in your groin, but spelt differently, obviously.
And then I looked around everywhere, but there was nothing. You know, it's just barren coastline and one pub. So I went to the pub and just got them to call the RSPCA and see if they could find anyone for it. And luckily, it had a chip inside of it, and so they were able to find the owner.
But how did this dog get out there in the first place? Was it chasing a catfish?
The dog slipped the collar of a potential new owner, and the dog bolted. And I just panicked, I guess, ran along the groin, or just saw this as his last moment of freedom. And then the tide came in and just caught him out.
Sounds like you and that little Shih Tzu had quite a lot in common.
Yeah, God knows when that dog last had an adventure, but this Shih Tzu went on one for sure. It was a nice ending to a really hectic holiday.
That's it for this time, but come back soon, because as we've seen, there's a whole world of wild holiday moments out there. So what are you waiting for? Go on, knock yourself out.